Mr. Pressler?
Yes.
Mr. Messerschmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Gabbard?
Yes.
Mrs. Ashcraft?
Yes.
And Mr. York?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0.
At this time, we have a presentation by our Choraleers.
We do. So it's with great pleasure. You can see our nice participation in the audience. One board member said, is there any type of issue I'm not aware of? With such great participation. So we appreciate all of you being involved and this evening. And it was brought to my attention early on when I came to Edgewood, what a great job the Edgewood Choraleers do, not just locally, but on a regional, state level. And I was so impressed when I saw them that I certainly wanted to just celebrate their good work with all of you. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you the Edgewood Choraleers under the direction of Libby Wolf.
I texted her and told her it's sitting on the stage right underneath the red mark right on the stage there.
Hello, it's on. My name is Libby Wolf, and I am the choir director at Edgewood High School. And we are so thankful that you invited us to be a part of the board meeting tonight. The Choraleers are going to perform for you, kind of just in honor and celebration of their $1,000 cash prize that they won on December 21st for the Middletown Holiday Hoopla. They did their Christmas show there and were able to earn a pretty big hunk of money towards our program. We're pretty much self-funded. All the things that you see happening here with the costumes, the lights, the camera action, that's all through our boosters organization. And like I said, these kids put in a lot of hours. Here next to me is Mrs. Carmen Field. She is my assistant co-director, and she also runs the middle school program of show choir, which is the Overtures, who also compete. So you'll get a chance to see them maybe down the road at a meeting. I'm sure they would love that. But we are very excited. On Saturday, we're getting ready to kick off our competition season. Each year, our group, I have 62, I think, total kids in our program with singer-dancers. We have a live student band. We have a tech crew that runs and operates all the things that you see happening backstage. And we're going to hit the road on Saturday at Northrop. Indiana is going to be our first competition. We do five each season. So it's a lot of hard work. This program's been around for 42 years. This is our 42-year anniversary of having the Edgewood Choraleers. I myself was an Edgewood Corleer in the late 90s, so it's a really kind of amazing experience to be able to provide opportunities for kids similar to the ones that shaped me and provided me with so much in my high school year. So I have an amazing group of kids. We just, like I said, want to kind of share the product. We're going to do our first half of the show. We're not going to do the full show, so you have to come and check it out maybe later. But this is the front half of our show, which is called Back to Our Roots. So the first half is kind of finding our way and kind of exploring, and then the back half, which is a lot of fun, is kind of our country theme, if you will, where we kind of come back home and find our roots, right? I guess, yeah. But that's it, I guess. Yeah, are we ready to do this, I think? Kids, are you ready back there? Are you guys ready out here, I guess? Yes, they're ready, they're ready. They had a late rehearsal. We were until 9:30 last night, so they're like, yes, Mrs. Wolf. All right, here we go. We got it, so we hope you enjoy it.
Miles and miles and miles, traveled the world and back so many times, with nothing on my back but a guitar and a smile. Chasing a dream only fools like me would follow. I was born a soldier, waging a war against all that said I told ya. With my feet on the ground and my heart on my shoulder, and I don't mind if I gotta start all over.
Yeah. There's nothing like that place, my good old hometown. There's nothing like my home.
Fields stretching into space, late autumn ball games, not caring if we're freezing to the bone. Feeling like home now. Gotta go, gotta go home now. I know, gotta go home.
My good old place to go, my friends and family. Not perfect, but it's home. Yeah, that's the best I've known. The home-cooked dinners, the pencil marks show how much we've grown. There's nothing like
go on and actually perform in New York or LA.
Several folks that perform like Kings Island. We have one that just
That's
went on
awesome.
A tour for a cruise ship. We have some that are going to go to be in music education. So we have lots.
That's
of
awesome. Things, yeah. Well, thank you very much. You guys are doing a terrific job. So we thank you for giving up your evening and your time and sharing your talent with us.
Thank you so
you have
much.
A good night. Thank you. And it's going to take us just a minute to transition. We have a PowerPoint, and it's going to take a minute to move between these two things. So parents, thank you for bringing your children out and sharing them with us this evening. And board, you might want to stay seated, or you can, I probably just want to stay where you're at, so just give us a moment. So just to set up our next piece, I wanted to share with all of you just what we're doing in our schools and our community. And I think it's important for the board to understand just the past practices of our financial history and where we are today with going to the community in the spring. This is not a levy presentation, it really is just a fiscal update. But I'm not so sure. Even as a superintendent, I have to tell you, I learned a lot. I think Mr. York right here taught me a lot on the five-year forecast and the staircase and how that works. But when I first came to Edgewood for a board meeting in October, I have to be honest with you, when I heard of deficit spending, it made me a little bit nervous in regard to the amount. And in my mind, I was thinking, how in the world did we get there so quickly in year two of a five-year forecast? But if you do your homework, and that's what I hope to share with you this evening, just in regard to how funding's been set up in Ohio, what those legislative pieces are, how that pertains to local decisions, and compare our spending with our like districts in our county. So just to kind of give you just that little historical snapshot, and I'm running out of words. Are we almost there? Okay. So bear with us. So some of this information was taken, two slides were taken from your November presentation in regard to finances. Thank you, sir. All right, so as we are going throughout the community and our schools, I think it's important for people to understand how are we funded in Ohio when it comes to our school districts. And so often we hear of money, like how are we using all the lottery money? How are we using all the Racino money? So I think it's just, this is a nice little snapshot of history. So in 1825, our legislators decided that we really need to pass a property tax to fund our schools. So that decision was made in 1825. In 1934, just 9 years later, I think they found that that wasn't working as well as they thought, and then they implemented a 3% sales tax to assist funding in our schools. Yet the sales tax has been adjusted 25 times. We still haven't gotten it just quite right to how to fund our schools through sales tax. And in 1969, right here in our community, Edgewood School District was created through the combining of Trenton and Shiloh School Districts. Shortly thereafter, Ohio passed a lottery bill, which we all thought that was going to be the windfall. We were never going to have to go to our constituents for money again. Yet isn't it interesting that schools see so little of this money? Matter of fact, when the Racinos were implemented in Ohio, we've only seen $50 per pupil since. Let that sink in just for a second. So when people think, why are schools bleeding? I mean, basically, we are looking to our neighbors, our community members for funding. We're not getting help from the state as much as we would like anyway. Ohio school funding model was ruled unconstitutional in 1992, yet here we are in 2023 still talking about the same thing. We still haven't fixed it. The tangible personal property taxes were phased out. Now, what that looked like in districts were very different depending on where you fell, but there was less money to schools starting in 2005. The last operating, we're not talking facilities or asking for facility funding, strictly operating funds, not bond funds. The last operating for new money was in 2005. Matter of fact, we've renewed it several times since, but we've never gone to the community to ask for new dollars. So that's been renewed three times since. This slide you saw in November when our treasurer Patty shared with you our per pupil comparison to state average. You knew very quickly that Edgewood is spending less per pupil than the state average. Matter of fact, I'm gonna go back to that. We're spending less than our surrounding districts. All of our neighbors in Butler County are paying more taxes for their students to learn in their communities than Edgewood. So that's an important fact. So when I talked about attending that meeting in October, I'm like, okay, listen, we're just in a second year of a five-year forecast. How did this happen? And then if you go to the exact bottom of the slide, I don't think we realize how much inflation has increased. Inflation has increased 7.2% just in the past year. Since we went to the ballot in 2005, inflation has increased 50%, yet we've still been able to maintain our quality education at Edgewood. Yet inflation continues to increase. Salaries and benefits increase. Matter of fact, in a little bit, we'll talk about how much health insurance and benefits have increased. Yet the real kicker is the Rockies Pipeline Express. We thought we would continue to get fully funded in that revenue. We counted on that in our five-year forecast, and that pledge, that money is not there to date. We're hoping that comes through later. So this is just a slide talking about how the money is being spent per pupil. Most districts, most schools will say that their personnel takes up anywhere between 85 and 88%, so we fall well in the range of that. Whoops, excuse me. You will notice that Edgewood did a really good job in regard to trying to prepare for the inflation increases by eliminating some positions. I'm not going to read them to you. You know what they are, but that's several. So that was almost $1 million savings there, yet we're still in deficit spending. This was more learning for me probably than you, but you know, when you think about all the great things happening and then just some nuggets of information that just is good to know, I think it's good for the normal taxpayer to know that 1992 funding was deemed unconstitutional, yet the states never fixed it. Again, that burden falls on us as local community members. That when the state began rolling back property taxes, that became a greater burden on local taxpayers. Did you know that a normal levy cycle really is only built to run 4 years? So if the last new operating that we went out for funding was 2005, really technically we should have been back for new money in 2009. Well, because we went for a bond, I'm sure we pushed that out, but still, the moral of the story is it's been almost 20 years and we've just asked for renewals. Did you know that Edgewood community pays less property tax, less taxes than surrounding school districts? I didn't realize this. This was shared out of the treasurer's office the other day, that I always heard, I mean, I guess I always just assumed not many districts paid income taxes. Yet when we dug deep into that, 4 out of 10 school districts in Butler County have some sort of income tax that's funding their schools. And a third of the school districts in the state of Ohio have income tax funding model in their formula. The Edgewood School District per pupil is less than the state average. We talked about that, and it's less than surrounding districts. I don't think we get enough leverage out of this one. Did you know that Edgewood School stayed open during COVID when all or most of the neighboring districts didn't? That cost additional money, I'm sure. The last time Edgewood City School District asked for new money, we want to keep telling you this over and over and over again, was 2005. And look at the inflation that's gone up since then. Look at the insurance. Health insurance increased 8% last year, but if you take it back to the 2005 mark as the earmark, it's increased 176%. So I hope that when you look at that, it kind of justifies some decisions we're going to have to make in this community. Also, I think it's nice just to remind, I mean, I think our athletics is something that all Edgewood Cougars are proud of. Look at all the state qualifying championships, league champions. state players that you've been able to produce just out of the last 10 years. So when I met with families, and matter of fact, Mr. Pressler was in this meeting when we met with community members, we asked them to come up with one word to describe Edgewood School District. Look at this. They did a Mentimeter under Dr. Thor's presentation, and look at the words that jumped out. Community was the strongest. Pride, family, tradition, heritage, heart, home, and it goes on. I mean, I had goosebumps when the families were describing the Edgewood community. You know, we want this to continue. And I think one of the reasons I invited the Corollaires in this evening is that not only because of the wonderful performance and job they're doing as they compete, but these are the type of programs that when we really have to be pushed to making decisions, some of our neighboring districts are cutting down to state minimum. That's just your core subjects. So I guess I share this because it's time for our community to get together and really define what do they want the student learning experience to look like here in Edgewood. And so as you hear remarks over the next few weeks approaching spring, I just wanted to kind of put that in your cap of information. And sometimes when we're caught off guard as to why are we asking for money or why can't we continue to reduce, I think you can see here from the history, Edgewood's made some really nice decisions. They've made reductions, but now it's going to start hurting. So it's time for our community to tell us what they want to see. So, any questions? All right. You got a question?
Is this information out on the website anywhere?
Well, the reason you have to sit through this is we want it to go on the board, we want it to go on the website, we want to publicize it. This is what we shared with our community. There was more that actually talked about campaign that I took out. This is what we're sharing with schools, and we're asking for our committee that meets for the campaign to find us events that we can get into and share. And if you can think of anything, please let us know. You know, is there a Lions group? What kind of clubs? But I think that we really, the more we can educate, the better understanding we'll have. Good question. Anything else? All right. We'll carry on with our agenda. Thank you.
I think they're probably all gone by now, but I don't know if you can say enough great things about the Corollaires. Very impressive. And look forward to seeing them in Hanover.
Yes.
I saw that show at the fundraiser they did a few Saturdays ago, and I got to tell you, I was just as impressed the second time around as I was the first time. It's kind of hard to get on with a board meeting after watching something like that. It was an awesome show.
It really is. I mean, I felt like I was like at some sort of high-quality performance. It's amazing. Not too many districts have that quality.
Yeah, they do a great job.
Extracurricular going on, so kudos to Edgewood.
Next, we have public participation, and we don't have any. So we'll go to treasurer items. Ms. Bowers, would you like to start?
Yes, Mr. Gabbard, I would like to block items A, B, and C. That's the board minutes from the regular board meeting on December the 19th, the emergency board meeting from December 21st, and the board meeting for the organizational meeting that took place on January the 9th. And we would like a motion to approve these board minutes.
All right, I'm looking for a motion to approve the board minutes from A, B, and C, which would be three separate meetings.
So moved.
Mrs. Ashcraft, do I have a second?
Second.
Mr. Pressler. Mrs. Bowers, would you call the roll, please?
Mrs. Ashcraft?
Yes.
Mr. Pressler?
Yes.
Mr. Gabbard?
Yes.
Mr. Messerschmidt?
Yes.
And Mr. York?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. At this time, we would like a motion to approve the treasurer's items as presented.
I'm looking for a motion to approve the December financial report as presented.
So moved.
Oh, second.
Was that Mr. Messerschmidt?
Yes, sir.
Mrs. Ashcraft is the second. Mrs. Bowers, would you call the roll, please?
Mr. Messerschmidt?
Yes.
Mrs. Ashcraft?
Yes.
Mr. Gabbard?
Yes.
Mr. Pressler?
Yes.
Mr. York?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. Next, we're looking for a motion to approve two contracts for Applied Behavior Services.
I'm looking for a motion to approve the behavioral contracts as presented.
So moved.
Mr. Pressler. Do I have a second?
Yes.
Mrs. Ashcraft.
Oh, we don't have to know who it is.
Any discussion?
Are these new contracts, or are they ones from
They are new contracts. I attached them. I've taken the students' names out of it.
Due to IEP?
Yeah.
Driven needs?
Yeah.
Have we used these people before?
Yes.
Any more discussion with them? Mrs. Bowers, would you call the roll, please?
Mr. Pressler?
Yes.
Mrs. Ashcraft?
Yes.
Mr. Gabbard?
Yes.
Mr. Messerschmidt?
Yes.
Mr. York?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. At this time, we'll look for a motion to approve a consulting agreement.
I'm looking for a motion to approve the consulting agreement as presented.
So moved.
Mrs. Ashcraft, do I have a second?
Second.
Mr. Pressler. Mrs. Bowers, would you call the roll, please?
Mrs. Ashcraft?
Yes.
Mr. Pressler?
Yes.
Mr. Gabbard?
Yes.
Mr. Messerschmidt?
Yes.
Mr. York?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. At this time, I'm looking for a motion to approve the resolution to proceed with the proposed levy of an annual tax.
I'm looking for a motion for a resolution to proceed with the tax levy.
So moved.
Mr. York, do I have a second?
Second.
Mr. Pressler. Mrs. Bowers, would you call the roll, please?
Mr. York?
Yes.
Mr. Pressler?
Yes.
Mr. Gabbard?
Yes.
Mrs. Ashcraft?
Yes.
Mr. Messerschmidt?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. Next, I'm looking for a motion to approve the amended administrative and exempt compensation schedule.
I'm looking for a motion to approve the amended and exempt compensation schedule.
There was one cell left out, and I just added
I gotta
it
get
in there.
A motion before.
Okay.
So moved.
Mr. Prester, do I have a second?
Second.
Mr. Messerschmidt, discussion?
Yeah, I was gonna ask what changed.
There was a cell left out of the first column in level 4. I attached what was approved in March, and then the second page is the new one adding the column. It was the Director of Federal Programs and Communication. It was not put into level 4.
Any more discussion? Mrs. Bowers, would you call a roll, please?
Mr. Pressler?
Yes.
Mr. Messerschmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Gabbard?
Yes.
Mrs. Ashcraft?
Yes.
Mr. York?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0. The only informational item that I have to share, we recognized all of y'all at the organizational meeting, but I just want to tell you again, we do appreciate you in this Board Member Appreciation Month for everything you do. So thank you for being here to support our community and our students.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have superintendent items.
Yes, at this time, I'm looking for a motion to approve item 6A OHSSA membership for the 2022-23 school year. This is an annual procedure. I would think that would be the 23-24 school year.
I would.
It says 23-24 on the actual.
Thank you.
Document. Yes, it does.
Okay, so that was an error. It's a, as presented on the document.
I'm looking for a motion to approve the OHSAA 23-24.
So moved.
Mr. York, do I have a second?
I second.
Mr. Messerschmidt. Mrs. Bowers, would you call the roll, please?
Mr. York?
Yes.
Mr. Messerschmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Gabbard?
Yes.
Mrs. Ashcraft?
Yes.
Mr. Pressler?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0.
I'm looking for a motion for item 6B. Anytime we have controversial materials, we need to present to the board. And just a reminder that parents do have and students have the right to select different materials if they disagree. But our high school junior class is looking for approval to teach the books Obsessed in the Year We Disappeared in the junior English class.
I'm looking for a motion to approve the two high school books as presented.
So moved.
Mrs. Ashcraft, do I have a second?
Second.
Mr. York. Discussion is...
So there are two others?
There are two books that should be attached. The two high school book rationale, it's actually in one link, Mr. York. Mm-hmm. And so the book... The first book is called Obsessed by the author Allison Britz. The other is The Year We Disappeared by Busby and Busby. But basically, both books, the controversy is around language. There also could be some discrepancy in regard to religion. And the second book, Violence. So it's language, discusses religion, as well as possible violence.
Yeah, it said one of four. I thought there would be two others.
The other two are not controversial.
Gotcha.
We asked them a few years ago at any time, any novels that they're reading to present to our group, and then we bring them for approval. So there are two other books that are already been approved that they're reading in their courses. So we're trying to provide more variety for kids to choose. So these are two of the four. The other two are already in play in our curriculum. That have been approved. I can't tell you exactly what those titles are right now.
Yeah, that's okay.
I'm going to need that information.
Okay.
The other two courses? Absolutely.
It's my understanding both of these books are based off of a true story. I did some research. I haven't read either one, but I did some research, and I personally am okay with it. I didn't see anything in there that had me necessarily concerned.
It's a junior level course. They do have an option to read different material.
I'm going to say it's probably not anything worse than what they see on TikTok or Instagram.
Kids are exposed to an awful lot, and this is not something, this is way a level or two or three or four below what they normally see every day in TikTok. So our English department does a wonderful job of teaching, and our guidance department probably be tipped off. Maybe somebody's, hey, by the way, we're reading some books. Maybe there might be some kids that want to talk. I don't know, but anyway, I'm good with it.
They both had pretty good reviews from what I read.
Any more discussion?
No, sir.
Mrs. Bowers, would you call the roll, please?
Mrs. Ashcraft?
Yes.
Mr. York?
Yes.
Mr. Gabbard?
Yes.
Mr. Messerschmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Pressler?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0.
Amy, we will get the names of those other two books, too. Are you sure?
Spot, yeah.
Okay, all right.
I was just trying to torture him a little bit.
No, I was going to have him get busy. Okay. The next item, I'd like to propose that we block items 6, C, and D. They both are pertaining to either in-school or out-of-school field trips. Looking for a motion as presented.
I'm looking for a motion to approve. It looks like a total of 7 field trips as presented.
So moved.
Mr. Messerschmidt, do I have a second?
Second.
Mr. York.
I think the wrestling one needs to be resubmitted when it's filled out properly.
I will tell you, I did dig deeper even on the baseball one because I thought it was vague. And since they're still having tryouts, they are going to present the names of the players that will be attending, parent permission forms, and any medical, like who needs medicine and who's been trained to dispense it. So that's forthcoming based on who makes the team.
I want to say, Go ahead.
I agree. I'd like to see the wrestling one filled out properly and turned back in.
Okay.
I mean, that's March 10th, and
our we have time.
Where they're going to be staying is hotel. What's the benefit to children in A? There's no benefit to the students. I think you need to take a little bit of time and fill that out.
Okay, so do we want
you
after
can pull
this?
That one if
okay.
You can.
I want
are we
going to
pull that one?
I'm not in agreement with approving it. Yeah, I think we need to fill it out.
Yeah, I mean, I think it needs filled out properly, especially after what we just went through recently with
exactly.
It not being filled out properly. I think, you know, we need to have the same standard for everybody.
Yep. If you look at the
I
softball
agree.
And the baseball, you look at this, we need to listen like
it just sets a bad precedent if we don't.
We need more information.
Great.
Okay.
While we're talking
as,
about
okay, go ahead.
This,
I'm sorry.
Wrestling in particular, I want to say a thank you to the AD, Mr. Cox, for we have girls on our wrestling team, and Mr. Cox went above and beyond, I think, to make sure that girls were included in some wrestling tournaments that they originally weren't included in, and he took it upon himself to make sure they had the opportunity to wrestle. OHSAA has recognized girls wrestling as a sport, and we have girls that wrestle, and we should make every effort that they have available to them the opportunity to participate. And AD Cox did that, and I know that made some parents really happy that have girls that wrestle. So. Good job, Mr.
Good stuff.
Awesome.
So we're going to do this as amended?
Well, I got one comment I'd like to make before we
sure,
vote on this.
Sure.
So, you know, we talked about what we're doing with the Corleers and the awesome opportunity that they get, but I think it's worth mentioning, if you look at this one on this baseball trip with what Ralph Lunsford is doing with our baseball team and giving these kids an opportunity to go down to Myrtle Beach mm-hmm. to play baseball, I mean, that
compete.
That is just mm-hmm. unbelievable in terms of an opportunity. That's something that they'll remember forever. And you know, I just wanted to give a shout out to him for putting all this together and bringing it together and setting it up and planning it and doing all the things he's doing, because this is a great trip. This is a great opportunity, and this is just another example of Edgewood having these opportunities because of the people and the community support. I just thought it was worth mentioning. This is a great thing for this team.
Thank you. So we want to do 6 field trips as presented, and we're just going to pull the wrestling.
That's what I hear.
All right. Do I need to go back with a motion on that, or are we just going to vote on it as presented, as amended?
I think as amended.
It's amended.
All right.
And I'm writing that email right now
okay.
to get that information, right.
So I'm going to go back and look for a motion to approve these 6 field trips as amended.
So move.
Mr. Prestler, do I have a second?
Second.
Mrs. Ashcraft, I think we've had the discussion. Mrs. Bowers, would you call the roll, please?
Yes. Mr. Prestler?
Yes.
Mrs. Ashcraft?
Yes.
Mr. Gabbard?
Yes.
Mr. Messerschmidt?
Yes.
And Mr. York?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0.
Next item is certainly just superintendent update. I want to share with you that my goal is to put out a top 5 news each month as that's aligned to our strategic plan, which is around instruction, innovation, operations, and community engagement. And so again, we featured our Corleers, who did a great job in their regional competition. Some innovation going on. I was impressed with the prisms goggles being used at the high school in regard to your math courses, and certainly appreciate the risk-taking going on there. And again, the community engagement piece, just the words that stand out on the page that our community said about Edgewood community speaks volumes of the things going on in Edgewood. So kudos to our staff. It's all about them. They make these things happen, and we certainly see them and want them to know that.
The next piece is a legislation update that I just want to keep you aware of and put it on your radar, but you may have read Senate Bill 1 in regard to the governor wanting to take over the Ohio Board of Education. I just hope you read that closely and certainly write to them if you see any reason for it. I'm just amazed at the overreach that occurs in legislation, people making decisions without incorporating the experts. And it's just a pet peeve of mine, and I'm really concerned to see where Senate Bill 1 is going to go. Although it's not dismantling the Ohio Board of Education, they still will use them for maybe some project work, group work, but it's just a way for one step away from just overreach, in my opinion. So that's just Kelly Spivey. I'm not speaking on behalf of your school district. The last piece, just want to talk a little bit about, is our safety committee. As you're aware, we had public participation in regard to our bus accident. We were putting together a quarterly safety committee just to review our protocols and our processes. Certainly invited parents in. Mr. Combs did come into our committee, and you know, a light bulb went off. You know, it's so easy to sit when you hear concerns and say, well, we have this on our checklist, we're doing X, Y, Z, but you really listen to one-on-one and how that impacts a family. We are changing one of our protocols. So when there's a bus accident to the level of a bus is being towed away, doesn't matter what the safety officials say, they are gonna work with us and we're gonna take the students back to the school. So that's gonna be our deciding factor. It's not just the wind being blown when we take students back, but if the bus is damaged to the point where it's being towed away, that's a good indication maybe we need to take an extra look, spend a little bit more time with our students. So I found it rewarding, and I'll tell you why. He explained that his students got off the bus and had to walk, I don't know, it's a longer driveway than many, and they went to an empty house. We thought they were okay, the paramedics thought they were okay, but there's nothing wrong with having that face-to-face, eyeball-to-eyeball contact when a parent comes and picks up the student. So that's something that the safety officials and district admin said, we can tweak, we will certainly do. We also are meeting with our county official, safety management, and planning some quarterly tabletop activities for next year and another functional drill that we think we could work more cooperatively with Butler County as well as Trenton at the table. And by the way, they both were at our table, safety officials. So I found it to be a healthy exercise, healthy conversation. So just wanted to keep you up to date on that. We have some work to do, we're doing in between, but our next district safety meeting is April 28th, yes.
I did get some positive feedback on the safety meeting, so
oh, good.
I think that we're definitely moving in the right direction. You know, I've said it before, and I really believe that the most dangerous thing these kids face on a daily basis is their trip to and from school in a lot mm-hmm. of situations. And I think if you look at what happened at Lakota yesterday, they had a bus accident.
Yes.
It was on the news.
And Liberty, yes.
Brings it all kind of back, you know, back into the spotlight. So appreciate you taking the time to do that. I think it's definitely something that's needed, and I hope we don't need it again, but
right.
If we do, it's nice to know we've got a really solid plan in place.
Well, we're moving that direction anyway, hopefully. So that completes the information update from the superintendent.
Thank you, Ms.
I got another question.
Sure.
Shifting gears.
Yeah.
I hate to bring this up, but I think it's the school lunch thing that goes into effect tomorrow.
Yes.
So I know we've made a stance on lunch.
Mm-hmm.
It was brought to my attention by a couple of people about breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
And it bothers me to think that we would turn away a kid who doesn't get an opportunity to eat breakfast with no other option. I would like to have some discussion about possible contingencies in that scenario, and I don't know how many kids this necessarily will affect, but it was brought up to me by several people from several different buildings that this was a real concern. There are some kids that if they don't eat breakfast will not They will not eat before they get here. They will not get an opportunity to eat it at lunch, and some mm-hmm. may not have eaten at home. So I think we need to have some real conversation.
So we're going to revisit what, so this, we've put out all this communication. It's kicking in tomorrow. We're going to revisit where we are on the 24th with administrators to say what's working, what's not working. What should we take to the board to revise that guideline? So how that works right now, Mark, is that, and we had a really heated conversation today with a couple cafeteria people. So if you heard that Mrs. Spivey got heated, it was true. One excuse after another as to why we cannot implement this policy with the amount of money that is owed. No one's saying that we want children to go hungry. I mean, if you take a look at me, Kelly Spivey's not going hungry at all. So that's not the clue, that's not the direction. The direction is to be accountable, get in front of it. So Mr. Jewell's been asked to have a little window with that $15. They should know way before they come to lunch. We should have been meeting with families all this time to say, you have this amount. So what we're saying is, if you owe 15 or more, you're not going to get extras. Do you know that people have been charging extras? So when you're looking at some families owing $500, some of that's been on extras. They're getting the hot lunch and extras. So there's so many variables to this. We just took a hard line and said, this is where we're at. We're going to reevaluate it in a couple weeks. We're not asking for anyone to be starved. Matter of fact, some buildings are setting it up where they'll have food to give to them. But the bottom line is, where do we start? Where do we stop?
So I'm specifically referring to breakfast.
I know, but they're still charging that. So there's some families that owe over $100 that are still charging breakfast. Where do we stop? That's the question. So they've been told, and we're starting tomorrow, and then we're going to relook at this on the 24th. If you want me to let them know we're not doing it, that's fine. But I think they're just, the people implementing it are just as frustrated as we are.
Do we need to wait till the 24th? Could we maybe move that up a little sooner and take a look at it a little? Just kind of.
You tell us. You're the board. I just caution you that we look very wishy-washy in this. But we will do whatever you tell us to do.
I'm gonna be honest. Like ever since we met, are we allowed to discuss this anyway? Since it wasn't on the agenda, or
well, it could be board.
Oh, okay. All
right. Moved right into board.
So, anyways, yeah. I've thought about this and I've brainstormed it, because ever since we made the decision originally, like, you know, it wasn't an easy decision. Mm-hmm. But at some point I've sat there and tried thinking, you know, if we were to continue going in the direction we're going, well, then now, you know, now we're talking about cutting positions to fund that. So, mm-hmm. you know, you're talking about like somewhere the money's got to come from somewhere. And for some reason, it seems like people think that the public schools have like an open checkbook, you know, mm-hmm. like we can just, we got funds, you know, we'll come up with the money. But I mean, I've sat there multiple days at work, you know, and thought, and I don't know what to do. I mean, this is the only thing I know is to go this route, and in no way do I want any kid to not eat, or, you know.
No, matter of fact, we backed off on some of it. We did say, you know, I even said to the cafeteria people, I'm not sure where we fall on this with free and reduced, to be honest with you, because I'm having a real hard time of the bill that's been calculated up, and then all of a sudden now they qualify. I'm almost saying we're not touching that. And also, we're allowing kids to have hot lunches that are on reduced no matter what, you know, because their rate of charge is only 40 cents. So we're kind of putting that in a box to say, let's evaluate this on the 24th. Where are we? But we're not, I agree with you. Some of these kids, this is the only place they get their food.
How do you get on reduced? I mean,
you fill out an application, and basically you list the members in your household and what your salary is, and it's all government driven by a formula.
So we need to stress the people to get.
Oh, we send that every time we send out a lunch charge, that application's resubmitted to the family.
Okay. So low income, there is an option for low income, and all right.
And there's the issue used to be that kids didn't want to, they were ashamed to do that. Because there wasn't technology being used, and I'm assuming our kids enter a digital ID, and no one knows that comes up, and so forth and so on. But so everybody should be able to eat lunch. That is, if they qualify for free and reduced, that they apply for free and reduced, they can get lunch. And I think we'd have to look. Somebody needs to take a look at what those charges are. Are they getting their free and reduced lunch and then charging cupcakes and donuts? And
yes, but we're looking at that right.
Stuff. That's mm-hmm. usually what happens, Mark. Instead of them not getting the basic thing that they need to sustain themselves, it ends up being junk food. Because I've stood and watched kids for years go through the line, take their lunch, and get all these other things, and then dump the lunch at the garbage can as they walk by and eat potato chips and stuff.
I agree with Mark, though. I think he was talking about mm-hmm. breakfast.
Yes.
which I do.
One of the proposals, I had a call literally right before I came to the meeting, and that's why I brought this up. And the call was as if there was just something that we could give kids who don't have the ability to get lunch or to get breakfast, something to hold them over. And you know, it was mentioned specifically was Pop-Tarts, and you know, I don't know that's necessarily mm-hmm. the right answer. Maybe a piece of fruit or something. Mm-hmm. But I would really like to think that we had the ability where we, you know, because we've got a different option for a lunch for folks who've got the debt that they've incurred. Mm-hmm. But I really would like to look at some other kind of option, maybe something that we could have for that kid. If they come in and they haven't ate since lunch yesterday and there's nothing there for them, to have a piece of fruit or something to get them through. And I'll be honest with you, I'm a very compassionate, you know, big-hearted kind of person, and it just really bothers me mm-hmm. to think that we've got kids that are hungry there, especially the younger ones. It's not their fault.
I agree.
So I think that there mm-hmm. are... I think we could have maybe some more discussion. I think there might be some sort of other option that we have specific to breakfast. And I would just ask that we take a look at that.
I'll do whatever you guys tell us to do.
If they're on free and reduced, they get free or reduced breakfast, correct?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But if they owe money, breakfast was put in the same group as extras. So maybe if that's okay. just backed off of for the reduced, maybe that goes away.
Yeah, so... lunch is a requirement by the state. Breakfast is not.
Right.
So, and that's why this is a different discussion.
Mm-hmm. And there's reimbursement from the state for lunch, but not breakfast, correct?
So
it's just at the expense of Edgewood.
If they're on free and reduced mm-hmm. and they have, they're in the hole.
Mm-hmm.
They're not going to get breakfast, but they still get
No. Free is free. And we're just talking about how we collect their debt from before. We don't have an answer for that today.
Okay.
That's kind of put on a back burner. Reduced, because they do pay, we're saying no, if they have $15 charge or more, as the guideline says, there's no extras. We're still saying they're getting a hot plate lunch no matter what, because their lunch is 40 cents. We're not giving them peanut butter and jelly, mm-hmm. okay? So they get to keep, although they get to keep going at that 40. The thing is this, breakfast is not reduced, so Edgewood's paying for that. I mean, we don't get any reimbursements, and I hear what you're saying, who cares? That's a kid that needs to be fed. That's just different than what our guideline says, and so we need to change it.
Breakfast?
I think breakfast is $1, $1.50.
It's $1.50.
$1.50.
But what's the reduced price for it?
Does anybody have that answer? Jenny, you're in the room.
I think it's 30 or 35 cents.
Well, this is done on such an individual basis, in my opinion. Principals know who don't have the money to pay to eat. I'm 100% positive that they would be taken care of by either out of their own fund or out of their own pockets. I could see that happening. I mean, I don't know how we get it. I don't know how we get a handle on it if we don't stick to something, see what's going to work, and make adjustments as we go. I mean,
we have principals out there. What do you guys?
What do you think?
Principals
about breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we have some kids that treat it as a social time. So some of the parents that I have contacted will say, "Well, they eat breakfast at home," but
so do we know, are those kids on free and reduced, or are they their parents don't sign them up, or
they're not.
Means see that kids are hungry, and I wondered when you said there was more on Friday. Did it have to do with they're not eating on the weekend and they're storing up? That's what went to my head. So I don't know, but we will. In principles, if we need to meet sooner than the 24th, I'll put that out as well.
And I think that's a good plan. I really appreciate, you know, the insight from the principals and everybody else, and I appreciate your willingness to listen, so thank you.
No, absolutely. And again, hey, this isn't my guideline. We'll do whatever you guys tell us to do.
Let's stick with it.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, we're changing our agenda up a little bit. Was you done? I'm sorry.
Yes, I am.
Thank you, Ms. We've moved informational items from the board up before executive session. So, Mr. York, would you like to start?
Sure. I passed out, if you didn't get one, it's because Andrew held on to all of them, didn't pass them down. But this is the student success newsletter from Butler Tech. On the front page, you can see they're highlighting the Dooley Award to the Police Academy grads. Denise Dooley is there in that middle picture. Brian, it's in memorial to Brian Dooley, who was an Edgewood grad, was killed in the line of duty in Warren County several years ago. But they do a tremendous job of raising money every year and give that to the people in the police academy for further education. So that's a direct Edgewood connection there. Some great stories, so take some time to read them. If you haven't, take a look at what the Cafe Lee menu is, and make a point to go over there and have lunch sometime if you can.
I'm always impressed with their programs. Nice, thank you for sharing.
Mm-hmm.
So I've got four shout outs. I just wanted to mention Larry Cox sent out an email with winter athlete GPAs, and our winter student athlete GPAs were 3.26, which is pretty impressive as far as I'm concerned. And then I also know there were an awful lot of students across the district that had honor roll and different things like that. So really, really exciting times to see our students doing really well in school and then also doing well in athletics. I had an opportunity to go a couple weeks ago and watch our eighth grade girls basketball team play. I've got a niece that's on that team, and I wanted to give a shout out to them as they are the SWAT co-champions. So that's a pretty exciting time for that team. And then just to throw it out there one more time, we talked about the Corollaires an awful lot tonight, but I think it's really worth mentioning what Carmen Fields does with the overtures, because that's a pipeline that feeds the Corollaires, and I got an opportunity to go watch them in their fundraiser, and the overtures do a phenomenal job as well. So just really excited with all the programs that we've got. We've got so much talent in this district, and we've got some really intelligent students, and I think they're worthy of recognition. So that's basically all that I have. Thank you.
I want to interject on what Mark just said. I've listened to a lot of Corollaire concerts over the years, and these guys, if this is the beginning of their season, they are way ahead of what I've seen in the past. They're doing such a good job. So I think they're going to do nothing but no wonder they won $1,000 whatever it was they went. They're going to we got to find a bunch of those where you win money, because I think they could do a really good job.
There's another part to that show that will blow your doors off.
I can't wait to see it. But yeah, fantastic, wonderful job. Libby does a wonderful job with them, and I remember seeing her perform, so I'm really old.
Thank you, Mr. Pressler.
I'd like to give a shout out to our swim team. I seen a post earlier today, and I was on our Facebook page, and I was amazed by the number of placers that we had. So I thought that was cool. And then I'd like to give another shout out to Jeff King. He actually stepped up and volunteered to coach the two young girls in the all-girl wrestling tournament.
Oh,
so
awesome.
Like to give him a shout out for doing that. I think that's awesome. I'm excited. I'm going to have to go check them out.
Thank you, Mr. Pressler. Mrs. Ashcraft?
Thank you. I just want to let everybody know, you know, I'm a big supporter of FFA. I do belong to the FFA Alumni Booster Group. We meet this Thursday. We do have a quarter raffle coming up on February 11th at the cafeteria at the high school. That supports all the kids who go to the fair and lets the alumni bid on their animals. Also, it provides scholarships for five students every year through the FFA. If anybody's interested and wants to help out with the booster group, we do have that meeting on Thursday at 7 in the ag room. And then the auction is Saturday, February 11th at 7 o'clock. The doors open, but it's a insane sort of situation. You have to go to see it to be able to understand how it works. But it's a lot of fun and hopefully raise a lot of money to support those kids, because FFA, I think, is one of our Butler Tech programs that just absolutely helps blossom our children.
Thank you, Ms. Ashcraft. The only thing that really I wanted to add to everything that, there's really nothing else to do besides get out and support these kids. It's too cold to get out and do anything else, so you might as well come and support the kids. So hopefully we have a big turnout for the Corleers over in Hamilton. Other than that, please.
And the FFA.
He's already brought that up. So I really don't have a whole lot to add, but at this time I'm going to ask for a motion to move to executive session.
So moved.
Thank you, Mr. Messerschmidt. Do I have a second?
Yes.
Mrs. Ashcraft. Mrs. Bowers, would you call the roll, please?
Mr. Messerschmidt?
Yes.
Mrs. Ashcraft?
Yes.
Mr. Gabbard?
Yes.
Mr. Pressler?
Yes.
Mr. York?
Yes.
Motion carries 5-0.